Fabio, as a designer, as an architect, and obviously he's also our scientific director. Besides all this, I think he's probably a provocateur as well. He has an irreverent approach toward design, whether this, and we can see this whether in through his architecture, interior projects, or his design as well. This irreverent approach, when you say irreverent, that, you know, that means a disagree or an unexpected lack of respect for the authority or even religious aspects. This is definitely an approach from Fabio. I'm sorry, I don't mean to. I just absolutely, it's not a criticism. This is actually in this irreverent approach. Fabio actually has a profound respect for design, the Italian design, the Italian design system, but he's an innovator from the inside, and that's one of the reasons he's so appreciated within Domus and contributes to guiding what our students are doing, where they're going, and the thoughts about it. With that, I will leave the conversation to Fabio and Caterina. Caterina Lunghi is a journalist specialized in design and also a longtime collaborator with us at Domus Academy. So please, thank you very much for being with us today.
Thank you, Mark.
Thank you.
Hi, everyone. So my name is Caterina Lunghi, as Mark already anticipated, and I'm joining you from Lake Como, from my garden. So the computer is burning up. There is a crazy sun. Hope everything will be fine. I'm super excited to have this chat with Fabio that I think better than you can embody the visionary attitude and also the cross-disciplinarity of Domus Academy in perfect balance between past, but is always very the title of Pass Forward. Fabio, now you are a star of design, but you were a student too, right? You studied architecture in Milano, you are a guy from Southern Italy. I'm curious about your first step studies. There is a nice episode with Ettore Sozzas that kicked you out. So you were quite a crazy young boy, right? Still you are crazy, Fabio. Right.
Let's define being crazy. Okay, let's define it.
In a nice way.
No, but in a nice way, of course. I mean, I like crazy people. I just said that, sorry for the glasses, but I have my window with a lot of sun, okay? So if I'm respectful, I take them. By the way, how can I take trying to take off the notifica messages, the notifica sounds, because probably it's annoying for all of you. Let me check. I'm not able to do it. Okay, it does. I don't mind. All right, so Caterina, I mean, if you're not crazy, you cannot start an idea of work like what designer is, you know what I mean? It's like, if you're not crazy, you cannot imagine being a designer. Sei lì, Caterina? Caterina? You know what's funny, guys? There is no feedback here. There's no feedback at all. So, okay, I'll go on talking, and I don't know if Caterina is still there. But anyway, if you're bored, I can entertain you with my guitar, right? So let's put it this way. If you're not crazy, guys, you cannot be designed. But in a nice way, I try to explain it better. Non mi ascoltano.
I'm here, Fabio. I'm listening to you.
But sente la mia voce? Can you hear my voice?
Yeah, I can hear you. I can see you very.
So, that's why it's cool.
Yeah, I hear you.
You you can hear me? Okay, guys, I go on. So, I said you cannot be designers if you're not crazy in a very nice and propositive way. It means. Basically, if you want to be a designer, you have the ambition to change the world. So you think, okay, let's disassemble what it is and try to reassemble in a new way. And it's exactly actually the condition we're finding ourselves now, right? I mean, we are in a quarantine, we are in a standby situation, we don't know how to imagine our future, and that's where designers are the most important figures. Because we try continuously every day to reimagine what we do, who we are, what we want, who we want to be surrounded with, which kind of objects we want to be surrounded with. So that it is kind of crazy. Because otherwise you would give everything for granted, right? I mean, it's like, okay, this is the sofa, this is the library, this is my mobile phone, this is the airplane, this is the train, this is the car. No, actually, no. We don't give anything for granted. Every day, we try to reimagine things as they could be in a better world. For example, I don't want to say anything about cars, but I'm not so empathic to cars. To me, they're really like old. It's not generation. It's like when, when our grandpas, actually before our grandpas, but they were so connected to horses, you know, because for them, it was the only possible way of moving around. And then it went to bicycle, and now it's up to cars. But we should try to imagine mobility in the cities in a different way.
But
actually,
Fabio,
this quarantine...
Fabio, you anticipated my last question. Let's go back to the first question.
But it's not, Caterina, the fact is, and this is also part of the lecture. There is not first question, and there is not last question.
You're right.
Everything is a circle. Everything is together. And that's very important, you know, because really what we ask you guys to do is to be able to put all the time your certainties on the table and we discuss them and try to re-put them in a different order. Because priorities continuously change. And look at us in our condition. You know, priorities drastically changed. How we want to reimagine our world. I mean, you know what, guys? Some people say that this is a very bad moment for the planet. We are all suffering, you know, the economy is going down. But did we ever have this time to rethink about our lives? Did we ever have this long pause to reimagine a different present? I mean, that's a great chance. And you know, it's different from a world war, because in world war, lots of people die. Here, it's true, some people are dying, but it's a very small percentage. And more than half of the population of the planet are locked in their houses. You know, let's call it a catastrophe. Is it a catastrophe? Yes. But there is a condition for catastrophes. You know, when you go through a catastrophe, you cannot imagine to go back to your world as it used to be. You should try to reimagine a different world, to reimagine a different order of things. And this is what we are asked to do now, especially we, designers. And you know, it's a great chance. I mean, we should consider ourselves lucky.
Fabio, I'm open to everything this morning with you, but can I ask Francesca to put the photo of you as an ancient medieval knight with your horse?
Yeah,
to go to the slide.
Okay, now I briefly explain these three pictures. The one on the left is myself, like crucified on the wall of my architectural school. It's Politecnico di Milano. And actually, the day after my degree, I went there. The whole school was painted in gray. I went there and painted the whole wall in pink with the red heart. It's like it was my signing. I was thinking, you know, if black is balanced by white, gray is balanced by pink. And so I was trying to balance the grayness of the situation of the school with this big pink wall, signing with the red heart. It was an act of love, of course. And you know, the result of my last thesis was the book in the center, the image in the center. You know, it's a book which I wrote. It took me a year. And the book was called South of Memphis. Memphis, for me, which is a movement that goes back to 1982 in Italy, founded by Ettore Sozzas, which is the old guy that you can see on the right side, was for me the peak, let's say, of evolution in design in a capitalistic way. So for me, going south, looking at south, was like looking at smaller cultures, at lower cultures, you know, what is called street culture and low culture. That was interesting to me. So south of Memphis was like moving your face from Memphis, which was the peak of the capitalistic way of evolving, to the south of the world, the poorer part. You know, and it took me 1 year. And you know, you should think, usually thesis should be the last exam, let's put it this way. For me, thesis.
For students at Domus, it's called the final master project. Is the same, right?
Final master project. It was not a project. I tried to reimagine completely the history of design, trying to sustain my thesis of trying to look at lower cultures, at the poor part of the world, in order to have important inputs to design a better world. And you know, it was, in some ways, it was very anticipating. It was published by a very important publisher in 85, a few years later, and I struggled, I fighted to have the introduction by Ettore Sozzas. Ettore Sozzas was not only my myth, you know, the mythology of design. Ettore Sozzas was God in some ways. And he was not only the founder of Memphis, you know, it was my myth, the founder of Memphis, everything. So yet to write the introduction of the book. And they struggled so much. I went under his studio many times and I was saying, you know, excuse me, I wrote this thing. It was about, you know, what you founded, which is Memphis, and I think we should evolve. And he was always kind of ignoring me, but in a gentle way. He was a very gentle man, a beautiful man. But I was so insisting and so annoying that in the end he said, okay, let's give a look. And he liked what I did. He very much liked what I did. And he did this introduction. And if I can tell you a secret, Caterina, he didn't have time. He was a very busy man. And so he said, okay, Fabio, you know what? Then my introduction will be vocal. You will come and I will talk and you will record and write down the words.
Wow.
And then, like the way you wrote it down, I will sign it. And that's how it went. And that's how I got an original text from Ettore, which is an amazing text. I mean, probably if I was you, I would buy the book just for the introduction. I'm kidding.
So you think,
you know, Caterina did Alessandro Mendini for many years. Alessandro was a big master.
We know in Italy because everyone knows you when you were a young boy with long hair. If we can go to that picture interview, not just Sozzas, but also Branzi, Dalisi, Vico Magistretti, Mendini. Let's go to that photo, please. So you had in Italy we would say the faccia tosta, the perseverance, right? Sozzas, but also with the others. So it was a precious and unique, I think, opportunity to meet the maestro, to also learn a lot from them, right, Fabio? Because also in your design process, you get inspiration from the past, from Nemo.
Of course, I learned a lot from all of them, you know. There's this beautiful sentence from Sir Isaac Newton.
Mm-hmm.
You should know who he is. And he said, I could see forward only because I could step on the shoulders of giants. So guys, this is what you should do. Sir Isaac Newton was saying that you should apply it. Step on the shoulders of giants. Metaphorically, symbolically, even physically sometimes, you know, I was almost going physically on the shoulders of Ettore to write the introduction of the book. So that it's very important, guys, to understand their lessons, to understand their heritage. You know, still, I go and read their words, their books, their messages. They left so many messages, not only design messages, written messages, everything. So we should go through these things. You know, I always say when, you know, all of us go through dark moments, you know, in our everyday life, because it's normal. You know, where you had a fight with the girlfriend, the boyfriend, or with your parents, or something went wrong at work. You think you are in the darkest moment of your life, but there are so many stars in your darkest nights. And these stars, they're very much shining, are your heroes, are the persons that you selected to be your heroes. And for me, these eight guys here in the picture, you know, Branzi, Magistretti, Bellini, Morozzi, Mendini,
Fabio, Andrea Branzi, Alessandro Mendini are also the founder in 1982 of Domus Academy.
Part of the mythology when I was a student, you know. Domus Academy was founded after I took the degree. And during. But it was a mythology for everyone. Everybody wanted to go and see what was happening at Domus Academy, because all the most important designers were coming there, invited by these people, because they were all personal friends. They were all personal friends of Mendini, of Branzi. These are the godfathers of Italian design. So when I decided to interview all of them, it was like entering their house, entering their studio, and trying to take out their secrets. I mean, they don't have secrets, because if you are a designer, you don't have secrets, because you output everything with your projects, with your words, with your writings, with everything. But for me, it was very important on an animal level to feel their energy. I really want to smell their sweat, to touch their hands. For me, it was very important to relate myself as the animal Fabio Novembre to the animals masters that I had selected. It was an amazing experience on a human point of view. And if you see the recording, you can feel that atmosphere, that tension, but
it was very intimate also, right? Very spontaneous, your conversation with them.
Totally spontaneous, because you know what? Before Caterina was saying faccia tosta is an Italian way of saying that you don't have to be shy. You know, life is too short to be shy. Why be shy? What the fuck? There is no, it's too late to be shy. Too late. What's the time now? 12:08. Okay, guys, from 12:08 of today, from now on, there is no more time to be shy. Finished. Go straight to the point. Straight to the point.
Ma Fabio, how the maestros also really inspired in a concrete way your design process? I have in mind the Joe Ponti sketch that became Nemo, the phantom chair that became him and there. Right, the social table. So not just from a human point of view, but you really applied their design into your contemporary, right, yes, design and products.
But Caterina, let's put it this way. We could say that no one invents anything from scratch. You know, life is like, you know, the run where you give the stick to the other person and they run the other part of the race. I think that life is exactly like that. You know, it's a continuous change of the stick, and you run a bit and another runs another bit, so that nothing, we're actually like a ring of the same chain. Everything is connected. What we do is unavoidably connected to what we have seen, to what we have learned, to what we have lived. So that, you know, I actually did a blog about that. It's called Io Noi. You know, and it has been going on for a few years, 7, 8 years, 10 years, something like this. And I always put there all the references. It's like saying, you know, if this new project came out, this project had a father, a grandfather, and the great-grandfather. And you can see the evolution line, the connection. And I'm not saying that the project doesn't deserve to be born. It deserves to be born. But you have to understand that he has a father, a grandfather, a great-grandfather, a great-grandfather. We go back to the origin of the world, because it's all together. We're all rings of the same chain. Nothing.
Fabio, since I've been teaching and managing worship at Domus Academy for a few years, I can tell that also is that what we do at Domus Academy that is really rooted in the past, and we give a lot of value to our founders in the history of design, but also in this time there is a the ability of Domus and also myself and my colleagues to try to adapt to times, to catch the spirit. So that's why I'm very happy about this title with you, Pass Forward, because right, Fabio, is the importance of respect the past and grab from it, but the same way to evolve, like you did, you still do. And also this is what I think Domus with the our classes, it wants to do, right? To catch also the contemporary times and the future that you were talking about before, to form students with many disciplines and the attitude to be very open, to catch every inspiration and input.
Caterina, let's put it this way. On my identity card, it's
written. You are also a musician. You also studied movies in New York, Fabio.
And no, but listen, it's very important. It's written architect now, but I would like to change it and to write student. You know why? Because my personal attitude is that I never stopped being a student. That's the main point, guys. You never can think that you stopped learning. You know, like you get a degree and you say, finished. I will never be a student anymore. I'm going to be a professional, a worker, whatever, market designer, whatever. It's bullshit. It's total bullshit. If you want to be a good man or a good woman, you have to keep on studying all your life. You never end up studying, never. And actually, the condition of the student, which is a beautiful condition, is an open condition. Like you're open to the world. The world, you will always accept any other theory different from yours. And that's being open. That's having an open heart. You know, that's the main point. You know, if you think that you go to school and it's finished, my God, you're out of your mind. It doesn't work this way. I still study. You know, I am appreciating quarantine so much because I'm reading like crazy. I'm reading like crazy. And actually reading is still a beautiful way, guys. I mean, documentaries are very interesting. There is beautiful documentaries now on whatever, on Netflix, on Amazon, on Apple TV, on whatever platform. Documentaries are interesting. But go try to discover these old fascinating objects, which are books. You know, actually, you know that in 1500, books were considered the most precious objects ever. You know, now let's say, which is the most precious thing you can, I don't know, to make a present to your boyfriend, okay? Caterina, you want to make a present to your boyfriend?
For me, these days, the Wi-Fi connection.
listen, Caterina, this is an interesting provocation. If you want to make a beautiful gift to your boyfriend, okay, now it could be a Ferrari. Okay, now your boyfriend would say, oh my God, I appreciate very much that Caterina gave me a Ferrari. In 1500, you know, the most desired object and the status was considered owning books. Books! And now we give them for granted and we use them to burn them in the fireplace. Isn't it crazy? Isn't it crazy? I mean, we give so many things for granted, guys. You never have to stop learning. And you know, the dimension of a school. Actually, let's put it this way, because you touched a very important point. Domus Academy is an Italian academy, which means for Italians, the past is very important. It's not that we don't look at the future. We obviously look at the future. I always say, some of you has already listened to my theory. You know, look at how human being is made. We have a front, a back, two sides, so that, guys, unavoidably, we have to go to look forward. We are designed in order to look forward, but we have to know where we're coming from. Where are you coming from? Where were you born? Which is the condition that brought you here, exactly here and now? Hic et nunc, used to say the Latins, here and now. But this here and now, which is a beautiful thing, I appreciate it a lot, but it's got a background.
And Fabio, also you said it right, it's an Italian academy with all the Milanese, the Italian value of design, our expertise. But also, Fabio, maybe because I really enjoy to be part of Domus Academy family, for me it's also very important and precious to meet our international students. Also, I think for you, right, to learn also from them when you travel.
When I was saying, who are you, where you come from, that's the richness of humankind. We're all different. We all come from different situations, and the putting us together makes us richer, you know? And actually, what I think it's interesting about the fact of being an Italian academy is the attitude. We give a lot of value to history, to knowledge.
Not just history and maestros, but also I think that I can really feel this from you, beside the passion, the human being at the center state of your design, but also friendship. You have a lot of friends. I'm a stalker, right, in a way, Fabio. You with Lorenzo Giovanotti, Saturnino, you're a friend from fashion, for photography. And also, I think that you suggest us, we have a lot of friends from different disciplines and fields because they also can enrich, right? You say, have a baker as a friend, as a musician. So not just from people from the same field, the design and architecture, but also to be open to other, and I really like this.
That's, Caterina, a suggestion that I always give to students. Never hang out only with your friends from work or your friends from university. It's not enough, because you will go on talking always about the same things. You have to enlarge the borders, you know, so that if your friends are from different backgrounds, if they have different knowledge, it's gonna be much better, much more interesting for you. It's like a diet, okay? Let's put it like a diet. You have to eat lots of different kinds of food that's very good for your organism. So it's exactly the same with culture. If you eat different food, your body will benefit. So you have to have friends from any other background, any other job, and also different levels of cultures. Because sometimes, you know, what people call the street university is as important at the classical university. You know what I mean? It's like learning is not necessarily in school, it's everywhere. It's a behavior. It's being open mind and open hearted.
And Fabio, you are from southern Italy, from Lecce, that you define a town of poor Baroque, if I'm not wrong. Yeah. And you were, as a child, playing in the piazza, in the square of Lecce. Then you moved at the age of 18 to Milano for Politecnico Architecture. Then also, Fabio, you went to New York for studying the movies. So again, you're super open mind. But Fabio, Milano, I think if you agree that is at the center of your career, right? Of your life. So what Milano gave you in the past, what Milano is giving you, and what Milano give to our students and the new generation? Of course, this day we are all in lockdown, but very soon we will be back to our normal and rich life with connection, a real opportunity to meet together. So what do you think of Milano as a capital of design, and also personally for you and for I hope our students that soon they will join you in Italy?
So, couple of answers. First of all, let's talk about Milano, okay? Milano is a very interesting city. It has got 1.4 million population. It's a flat land, it's a circle plant. It means it's small enough to walk through it even with your bicycle or even just walking, right? It's a pocket metropolis. That's a very important first point of view. And it's got water canals, it's got old parts, new parts. It's very enjoyable. I would say that it became very enjoyable. Caterina before was citing something I wrote a long time ago, which was saying that Milano is very great to me. I come from the south of Italy. There is spring all time. Let's put it this way. So I was not used to cold weather. I was not used to fog. I was not used to snow. It's even snow is difficult to relate to for me. You know, I've always been by the sea. But now the climate change as well. But Milano changed a lot. Milano is a very smiling city now. It's not gray anymore. It's, I would say it's sky blue. It's sky blue Milano now. It's not because today is sky blue, but because Milano feels that way now. Milano is a very open city with lots of students from all over the world, and lots of companies, and lots of culture. Because of course, as I said, it belongs to the network of metropolis like New York, Paris, London, Los Angeles, Berlin. You know, Milano is part of them. It's part of this very small network, but it's the smallest of them all. That's very good, because you can really leave the city. You know, I've been in places of 20 millions, 25 millions. You feel like this big. In Milano, you feel like your real dimension. But apart from that, I would like to give you the second answer. Before, one of the maestros that I interviewed was Ugo La Pietra. Ugo La Pietra in the 70s was suggesting to redesign the map of the city only through your relation to it. So thinking about places, only like saying, ah, there, I kissed my first girlfriend there. There, my daughter was born. Ah, there, I got my first assignment. Oh, there, I met my friend, I remember, oh my God. So you should try to reimagine places only related to your feelings. So that's the reason why Milano to me now is my place, let's say. Mm-hmm. I wasn't born here. I never thought I would have lived that long time in this city, but lots of beautiful things happened to me in this city. And that's why I feel like, yeah, it belongs to me. Actually, But let me finish. That's the behavior. Places should belong to you. And not because you were born there, just because you decided to live there. That's a very important point, you know. The whole world is divided in right of land and right of blood. You know, like most of the countries and most of the right-wing countries think, it's right of blood. It's, you know, I came here. My parents were born here. My grandparents were here. Fuck, no, it doesn't work this way. Places belong to the people that lives in there. Because they give energy to the place. They exchange energy with the place. It's not about being born there. It's about living there. Because it's a choice. It's a personal choice. You understand? The word divides into these two interpretations, right of land or right of blood. Stick to the right of land. That's the right thing to do.
Fabio, I wanted just to say that if Milano is your place, I think that also you represent Milano. Because when we think also Milano, the design, but also cultural scene, I think that for all of us, you also are Milano. So it's vice versa. So I think that you...
But at the same time, Caterina, I want to underline this. Everywhere, I travel a lot, of course, for work, I travel a lot. And I feel home in every place that I go. I mean, I don't feel Milanese, I don't feel Italian. I feel a real global citizen of the world. This is a very important point, guys, because otherwise you say, no, I'm Italian, Italy, Italy. Bullshit, bullshit. It doesn't work this way. Okay, you're Italian. Okay, I appreciate some things from Italy, some other not. But at the same time, I appreciate Thailand, I appreciate China, I appreciate the United States, Brazil, Madagascar, Norway. To me, everything is the same. All human beings that I want to consider like brothers and sisters. And I'm not being hypocritical, not at all. I'm not lying. You know, actually, there is a way, even if you don't speak the language of the country that you visit, you know which is the language that you can speak?
It of the love. No.
The local food.
I would say the language of love.
Language of love for sure. But, you know, I mean, actually, that they are related. Because for me, food and love, food is manifestation of love. I mean, I always related to my mother that was cooking for me and was her way of showing me her deepest love. Because she was feeding me. You know, feeding is exactly like what mother do. And who better than a mother can love their child? So feeding someone is like really loving someone. So through food, you find love. And eating local food, you know, I hate when Italians go abroad and say, only pasta, go to an Italian restaurant. I never go to Italian restaurants abroad. I despise it. You have to relate to local culture. It's very important.
I do agree.
It's a way of breaking borders. Our job as designers is breaking borders. That's so important.
Fabio, you also mentioned this at the beginning. So the role of a designer. How is the role of designer evolving and also changing also according to the current times and maybe also to deal, right, with the new needs that we all need in the world, unfortunately, for this global emergency? So design can face and help?
Design must face and must help, not can, must. And the evolution of design is this one, Caterina, and I can feel it on my skin. It's very generational for me. I mean, I started when computer didn't exist. I mean, of course, there were the Olivetti ones, but I was too young and everything was too in the beginning, the origin. But so I saw with my eyes and I went through this huge process of changing, going to analogic to digital, you know, from objects, real objects, to untouchable things. And that's the real evolution of designers, especially my generation, because of course, you know, the native digital, they can relate to everything, but it's all together. I mean, okay, let's put it this way. The risk of the native digital is to forget that we are made of flesh and blood. My risk is to consider only flesh and blood. We should meet on a middle point. That's very important, I believe, because we are realizing that we can be together in very different manifestations, in very different situations. For example, now we are all together. We are a few hundred people in a meeting, in a very digital situation, all over the world, and it's beautiful, beautiful. But as I said before, with the interview to maestros, I wanted to smell their sweat. I wanted to touch their hands. We are still physical animals. We shouldn't forget that. That's still something that is impossible to change. It's impossible to give another solution. We are made of flesh and blood. And that's what schools are for. I mean, schools, of course, they can be this way, and it's a beautiful way. But we should feel the energy of the people around. We actually give our best when we are surrounded.
Fabio, believe me that we do feel your energy also virtually today.
Seriously,
your vibe, your enthusiasm.
Different thing. It's very physical. Trust me. When you are in a room, when you are in a place, and all the hearts start pumping with the same rhythm, you can really feel it. That's why, that's actually the reason why, you know, that in the music business, now most of the artists make their money on live concerts. They don't make money on music downloaded all over the world. They make money on real concerts. And you know why? Because people don't want to abandon this kind of habit, because they want to feel the other people around. It's like a collective ritual. Okay, let's put it this way. Learning is an individual need, but when it becomes a collective ritual, it's beautiful. It's beautiful. It's like a mess. It's like a mess in the sense of church, you know? It's like a ceremony. It's a ceremony. You know, the ceremonial attitude of human beings is so important. It goes back to the origin of the world, you know? It goes back to our ancestors. It goes back to cavemen. Cavemen had their rituals. And still, our rituals imply being surrounded by other human beings. That's something we cannot forget. We must not forget. It's very important.
Fabio, I have a tough question. Yeah. So the maestros, you learned, and you're still learning a lot from them. You are still young in the design field. I mean, you are super famous with a lot of experience, but you are still fresh. So what would you like to leave as a sign for the future generation?
Caterina, believe me.
I don't want to say that you are old.
No, I'm 53 years old. I have no problems with age.
But you did a lot. So how would you like, not to me remember, because come on, you are here. But right, if you think about Sotas, Mendini, you know what they are left to us. What you would like to leave to our students, to the new generation, in the history of design, Fabio?
Caterina, trust me. I'm completely aware, I'm totally aware of the fact that we only survive in the memory of people that loved us. You know, like Mendini, Sosas, my mother, my father, they're surviving through me. But when I'll be gone, who's gonna remember them? It's very generational. I completely understand that, and I completely accept it, because everything is kind of generational. So that I accept and I appreciate, I even am happy for that my daughters, my granddaughters, my grand-granddaughters will completely forget about me. And even the people that study as I will completely forget about me. But it's okay. Everybody has to have his own references. I know, I'm aware that I can be like a guide for someone during the same time lapse, during the same period we are sharing together. And that's why I try to behave nicest as possible, because being an example, you have to be aware of the responsibility that you have. But as well, I am aware that will be forgotten completely.
Fabio, I appreciate your humble, but I'm not sure that...
Trust me. It'd be like that. Because memory of humans cannot last forever. Of course, they have some references. But let's say, for one Leonardo da Vinci, how many others have been completely forgotten? Plus, Leonardo da Vinci, for my generation, I don't know if our kids will remember Leonardo da Vinci. It's like, you know, it's... But I accept that. I'm okay with that completely. I'm happy for that. I like the fact, for example, just to give you a brief example, with my daughters, they are...
They are two pretty girls, and you love spend times with them and your classmates, right?
Exactly. So my daughters, for example, I don't force them to have references from my taste and from my time. I want them to select and to pick their own references. They have to love the things that surround them. You know, of course, they have to be curious to investigate the past, as I said.
Fabio, all our lecture disappeared if you don't say don't look at the past. So please confirm that.
No, that's very important. But you are living your time.
correct.
It's actually, you know, this fact of present is a very interesting, beautiful word. Present is the present time, the time we live now, but it's also a gift. You know, actually, in Italian and in English, the etymology of the word is exactly the same. Present time, yeah, and present as a gift. And we should live life as a gift. So that we never have to forget, as I said before, hic et nunc, here and now. But of course, my daughters know about their grandpa, about their grand-grandpa, and they can relate to them. But I don't want to overimpose. You know what I mean? It's like, live the present, being aware of the past.
And I'm sure that, Fabio, your daughters also have reference and heroes, maybe from TikTok, from YouTube, right? From Google.
They do, and you know what? I try to understand the reason why. I'm curious, you know? I am even, I'm on TikTok as well, you know, on Instagram, which is my direction. Well, it's like, I want to understand.
Fabio, you dance on TikTok?
I just play. I play on TikTok, I make music. So it's like, and actually, let me tell you something else. You know, I used to play when I was 16, I had a band and stuff. Then, when I moved to Milano when I was 18, I completely abandoned guitar. Now it's 1 year that I completely took it on, and I'm playing like 2 hours a day. I'm really obsessed with playing. And you know what? I understood the sense of it, because I try always to understand the sense of the things I do. I love music, okay? I love music. I'm in love with any kind of music. You know what? I want to filter everything through my guitar. When I like a song, I want to play it and sing it. I want to make it mine.
Fabio, the music at the end as a gift, as a present for everyone. Now I'm curious about something else, Fabio. Now you are at home. I'm in the garden outside my home. Fabio, I hope that you can invite me soon there. I have never seen your Casa Novembre house with my own eyes, but it's famous in Milano because it's a house and studio in the same place, in Via Perugino. So Fabio, it seems that you were a precursor, right? Now everyone is struggling to work from home, like me. And so how did you get the idea many years ago, right, to do that? The work environment connected to your personal space?
Caterina, it's a very simple question. I work a lot. The idea of being far from my daughters for many hours during my work would have meant to break me in two. You know, it would have broken me in two sides. One, the one side working, and the other one that was needing the presence, the physical presence together with them. So I put the two things together. I said, I don't want to lose any moment of their life. I want to be always there. I want to see when they will lose the first tooth. I want to see when they will, walk the first step. I want to be there all the time. I cannot separate myself. I cannot cut myself in two halves. So that I said, I need a place that is everything for me. But actually, Caterina, there are two way of looking at these things. I mean, for example, you know that my first wife left me for this decision. She said, be out. I you know, I don't want you always here. You know, I mean, it's like, it was part of the reasons why we speak. But so that you can see that there are different interpretations of this way of living. It's very different. You know, people think in different ways. For me, everything is together. You're not a designer and the man, or an architect and the father. You are all together. You are an architect, a designer, a friend, a husband, a father, a lover, a musician, singer, a writer, everything at the same time.
And Fabio, Fabio, I appreciate that you really open your also private life, your feelings, also to public, to journalists, because very often designers, in my experience, are also very, let's say, very cold. They want just to talk about the chair, the table, the aluminium, the marble, a little bit boring, also, I would say. So
absolutely boring.
So I do agree. I don't want to give names, but sometimes for me, staff, please tell me more. No, I just want to talk about my table for 2 hours. So I think that it's nice also for all our students today also to see your fun, your enjoyment, and your openness also to tell us about your life, that is your work. But Fabio, just because from your casa, from your house, that is also your studio, just because it's something that I really feel this day, the smart working technology. In the fall with the Domus Academy, you were the art director of a project with Google.
Yeah.
Right? And in that project, you tried to incorporate technology, in particular Google Home, like into our daily life, in everyday routine. That will be our future, Fabio, like to be human with technology inside, or human above all at the center stage, and technology is always behind, let's say.
That was exactly what we were talking about before. Mm. The digital native and people of my generation. You know, digital native are convinced that sometimes you can also skip lunch or not eat because it's not that important, you know, because your reality is always online. And myself, that always think that, hey, you're made of flesh and blood, still in your bed, you make the most important project of your life. You know what I mean? It's like, we're still made of flesh and blood.
It's like just noon.
No, but really, it's this is the main point. So that this occasion, and we have so many of these occasions at Domus Academy, was like putting Google, which is the most advanced point in, you know, I love Google. I must say I love Google. You know, Google is my splash page, of course, on my computer, because everything I research is on Google. Google is like it's my best friend. It tells me everything. So that trying to put together the reality of Google, and I remember when Google was born, you know, some friends from the United States came to me and said, which kind of research websites you have? Try this one. It's a new one. It's called Google. I really remember. I'm old. So, when we had the chance to put together Google and all the home accessories they're working on, and putting together with the real furnitures from Italian companies, it was fantastic. I learned a lot from the students that participated, joined this workshop. It was beautiful to work together, to exchange points of view. The output, the things that came out were interesting for everybody, for everybody. Actually, there is another image now, which is
Fabio, it's a surprise for you. And for me, this is really pass forward, because Fabio, you as an old ancient knight, but riding a horse. And Fabio, I listened to your TED.
You want to know the meaning of this horse?
No, I know that horse for you also, when you're talking about present time, Ferrari engine, we also refer to the power of real horses. So for me,
isn't it crazy that even in Formula One, in F1, you talk about these amazing engines still referring to horsepower. Isn't it amazing? And actually, there is another thing. In Italian, the big waves of the sea are called cavalloni, which means like big horses. I love that, actually. I love that. And you know what? Actually, cavalloni and the sea waves, the only way that energy spreads around is through waves. You, of course, know it. Any scientific book can tell you. So for me, it was about transforming this symbol of power, this symbol of movement, even this symbol of fiercer. You know, the horse is the most fearful of all animals. It's like so elegant in everything. So to transform the horse into a wave, for me was so important. Like, okay, I want the past. You know the like monuments in piazzas have always been like the sculptures of someone sitting on a horse. It was the most noble thing to do, you know, when you sit on a horse, you're so proud. So I wanted to design my own horse to make myself my own monument.
Fabio, where is this Dior now? He's also at Casa Novembre in the garden.
He's gonna come at Casa Novembre. He's gonna arrive at Casa Novembre because it was in exposed in London for many years, and now I bought it back.
Fabio, this was our present for you, the surprise of our modern night. So, Fabio, so if you want to give us your present with some music, would be very nice. And thank you very much. It was really nice. I would like to meet you and all the students in person sometime soon. Maybe invite us. Thank you guys for your attention.
Aspetta, Caterina, let's do something. It's very funny.
Basta che non mi fai cantare. Non mi sing, Fabio.
Aspetta, eh. This is very nice. This is very nice. Okay, listen to this, okay, guys? Penso che un sogno così non ritorni mai più. Mi piego le mani e la faccia di blu. Poi d'improvviso venivo dal vento rapito e cominciavo a volare nel cielo infinito.
Grazie anche alla Domus Academy. Fabio, sei il studente di Domus.
Nel blu, dipinto di blu.
Fabio, this is making history. Fabio, that you will be memorable for this. We have your sign.
Volare, you know, guys, volare is the most sold, the biggest hit in Italian music. It's a beautiful song. If you don't know it, just download it. It's called Nel Blu Dipinto di Blu, in blu painted of blu. But most people call it volare. It's a beautiful song, it's about fine. It's about looking at the blue sky. It's a very hopeful song, and it really represents Italy. So that next time, Domus Academy, we will all sing Volare together, okay?
I think that the Domus Academy director will kill us, Fabio, as soon as we finish. Thank you so much, Fabio. Thank you, Domus, for inviting me to do that, for the opportunity. Thank you, students, for all over the world. Hope you enjoyed the crazy Fabio. I told you that it was crazy. Thank you. Grazie, ragazzi. Grazie, a presto.
Grazie.
Ciao. Ciao.